Hello and welcome to another episode of our Chit Chat about Game of Thrones season 6, and this week we're talking about episode 2, which was titled Home. I feel like we should start on maybe not the most shocking bit of the episode, but the Boltons, because really? I feel like you have a lot to say about the Boltons, and we may as well get that out of the way now. I remember me and Connell predicting us Ramsay killing Roose, but I didn't necessarily think it would happen so early on in the season, and it definitely was against character for Roose Bolton to be so unaware of what was about to happen. But I'd like to get your take on it.
I didn't hate it that much. I think in the show it makes a bit more sense than in the books, because they just can't build up. Roose Bolton's not minor, but kind of medium characters that much. In the books, I do think he'll go down differently. I think it's plausible that it could go down in a similar fashion, but I think it'll be a bit more explained than he just grabs a dagger and just stabs him in front of two other people. And then says, I'm there. But I thought, watching the show, I thought the acting for it was really good. I thought Ramsay was brilliant all the way through the scenes, in killing Roose, and you can see his torn emotions and that kind of look in his face. But it's just, Ramsay's part in it all, I thought, was done really brilliantly. Just like Roose's, it was a bit like, yeah, but he's going to see it's coming. Oh, wait, he just did nothing and then died and didn't even say anything. I don't know. I thought the acting was really good. I didn't like it that much, but when Fat Walder and the newborn boy in the kennels, I thought that bit was, really effective, even if it was very grim. Do you know when you watch that, I wasn't that shocked, even though you've seen something absolutely horrific. I wasn't that surprised, because with Ramsay, you've seen.
Yeah, that to me was exactly what Ramsay would do in that situation. Mm. Do that creepy little hold the baby and sort of lead her into a false sense of security, and then bring her down to the kennels to be brutally murdered by dogs. I thought that was, and I saw an interesting thing about the two differences between Ramsay's character in Roose's death and in Walder's death and the baby's death, obviously. Basically, in when he murders Roose, he actually looks away from Roose's face in a sort of that split emotions character's going through. Yeah, and then when Walder and the baby die, he's staring right at them. I know what you mean. Near the end, doesn't he? Yeah.
I thought at one point, when he just releases the hounds.
Yeah.
He looks away for a split second, as if to say, even he wasn't enjoying it. He kind of looked away. But then he did look back after that, though. There was a moment where I did notice that he looked weird, and I thought they might be he really didn't like this at all. He might be sadistic. That's definitely interesting. I still think that's right, what you're saying. Roose gave him everything, so.
Yeah. Do you think Roose was just winding him up, or do you think Roose's plan all along was to just get rid of Ramsay altogether? Because I was getting the feeling with that conversation that he wasn't necessarily saying to... Because he still said to Ramsay, you're still my firstborn. So yeah. I wasn't getting the sense that Roose was going, right, you're not inherit to anything. But I did sort of get that feeling that he was sort of saying to him, look, if you mess up this, I can easily replace you with this young boy. Which might not have been a good tactical decision, but I thought it was an interesting... power play that Roose tried to play that obviously didn't work out.
My interpretation of what Roose was doing is almost kind of just seeing what happens in a lot of ways. I mean, it's still, they're still in a very compromising position, so Ramsay has his uses, and he makes a comment to him about Ramsay being a wild dog that must be tamed or something. I think he generally was trying to instruct him. I mean, they're both sadistic, but Roose is a bit more subtle. Like, he was talking about how he doesn't want the enemies to see all these horrible things that Ramsay's doing, you know, keep it, you know, hidden sort of thing. So I think he was actually just trying to instruct him that kind of way, and he probably was very shocked when Ramsay, I mean, it's possible he, you know, thought Ramsay would do something at some point, but he just didn't expect it right then. It was just that kind of...
What I mainly thought he would have got a reaction in the positive sense, in terms of Ramsay going out to prove himself even more.
Oh yeah, because he did do that originally, yeah.
Yeah, so I think that might have been his play, but I think he's given Ramsay too many toys to play with, and now he's eventually gone too far, and that's where Ramsay sort of realizes in his own head, not in terms of the actual case, but in his own head, that he doesn't need Roos to be powerful anymore. And that's obviously going to turn out to be...
Same way in the books?
What's that?
You think it'll go down the same way in the books?
I think your theory, where it's like sort of Roos doesn't outright kill Ramsay, but sort of sacrifices him in terms of sending him out to fight or whatever, or like if they're under siege or something, he just abandons them. That's what I think is going to happen, because that seems like a realistic approach to how that would go down, and that's sort of how George R. R. Martin like approaches those sorts of like relationships. So that would be like, I would see Winterfell under siege and then Ramsay dying in that sense. You might not even get like a moment in the book, you might just get like a comment about Ramsay dying, or they found Ramsay or something in that way. So
I think that's not much more to say in it, but I think in the books it'll possibly be quite a bit different. I mean, that's quite a bit different in a lot of different ways that don't just involve them too.
Yeah.
I think in the shows, they're speeding it up. You know, we've got Jon and the Wildlings and Night's Watch at the Wall. And they're going to come to the big clash, and I think eventually there'll be a battle where Jon Snow beats Ramsay in the show. But I think that's been kind of sped up and fast-forwarded and streamlined in the show. Whereas in the books, George R. R. Martin has said that there's quite a lot of people that are dying in the shows that might not necessarily die in the books.
Yeah.
I think with a hint at quite big characters. So, like, it's plausible... Stannis is still alive in the books, as far as we know.
Yeah.
He's sending for cell swords and whatnot. So I think the kind of that might be the end of it, but we're going a different way within Stannis, you know, wears him down, and there's a lot more to it, basically. There's not a lot more plot to it in the books.
Yeah.
So, we're just talking about a show, but what did you think of, like, how it was done itself?
Yeah, I liked it. Like, that was kind of the way I would have seen that going, is that Ramsay just stabs him in the gut, sort of. You get like a callback to season 3, I believe it was, when obviously Roose stabs. It's so funny how they play with like your emotions in brief seconds, is because you sort of cheer that moment when you get stabbed in the gut, but then you realize you're cheering on Ramsay, and you're like, well, no, this is worse. I'd rather have Roose than Ramsay. But I did like that whole setup. I was a bit confused about the Karstarks' involvement in it, because at first I understood why the Karstarks were teaming with the Boltons, but then for some reason that Karstark was evil. I didn't really understand. Like, there was no reason for him to be so like brutal about it.
My interpretation of that was that he just saw what happened, adapted to the situation, thought, right, look where he was. You know, Boltons are the Wardens of the North.
Yeah.
They're the most powerful house, and he's working alongside them. And he probably just thought, he just instantly understood the implications. Yeah. And he's like, I'm not going to speak out about this. I've heard about Ramsay's reputation. I'm just to support Ramsay. Makes the most sense. Just a very, like, in their world.
Yeah. Yeah, in all honesty, if he would have reacted to that, like, if he would have tried to do something about it, he would have just ended up dead anyway. So yeah, you're probably right in the sense like he just sat there and went, okay, the best option for me is to just go with this and get out of here with my head.
So. Especially like saving face at the time, even if you plan to do something about it, which I highly doubt it would. Just that, you know what I mean? They're looking for power. And we'll get Ryan's thoughts on the Bolton team.
Yeah, we've only touched on the Boltons, Ryan, if you can hear us.
Hiya.
All right. we've only touched on that scene with the Boltons. If you want to give your opinion on it.
I thought it was a good scene. I was confused at first at who was stabbing who, because I know you said, Glenn, that you saw it coming.
Well, the thing is, I that's how I thought it was going to play out. I thought it was going to be like near the end of the season, though. But that's how I thought it was going to play out. But I was still shocked by it when it happened, because it was so early on, and because the way they did it was sort of, you still were like, whoa, okay. So, yeah, it still shocked me. But
I thought it seemed too predictable. I don't know that he would stab him. I wanted it to be the other way round.
Not in there.
I just, and then have you said about the scene after where he sends the dogs on? Of all the things that he does shockingly, like getting a man's head crushed in, why can't we see people getting eaten by dogs? Yeah, why can't we see a woman and a child and a baby getting eaten by dogs?
No, right. The thing is, I don't want to see that. I don't care if it was brutal. I feel like that scene did not need it. The whole zoom in on Ramsay's face was sort of enough for me.
I know.
Like, I know what you're just like saying, but
if they'd have shown
I thought it worked better for not showing it.
Most shocking scene. It would have been more shocking than Oberyn's death.
They're not allowed to show stuff like that.
I wanted it.
No, yeah.
Now, even like no TV show can show like a dog more, literally mauling a baby. Like, you can't do that. There's limits.
Not in Ryan.
What a CG.
I want some baby mauling every episode. What did you think of that scene altogether? Other than wanting a baby to be mauled.
It was really good. It was hard to watch even without what I thought was missing. But yeah, it was still hard to watch. I was talking to my aunt about it, who's got a little baby, and she said she had to walk out of the room because she saw it coming. She knew it was coming as soon as he was stabbing him, and she was like, I had to leave. There was no way I was gonna sit there and watch. Like, obviously, she. They weren't going to show the whole thing, but just knowing about it, I'd like to. It would be interesting to kind of see a lot more of recent mothers' reactions to that scene.
That's going to be the new trend, isn't it? Baby mauled by dog.
Whereas us, we're just, me, and I'm just like, I would have liked to see it.
I think you're on your own.
Like, nah.
Moving on from the Boltons, because I feel like we covered quite a lot on that. Should we move to the wall? Not necessarily the big moment. We'll leave that till last, because...
What about doing Tyrion first, and then...
Sure. I'm not gonna lie, that scene to me was again another one about it was just sort of, look, Tyrion's good at politics, Varys is good at talking, that sort of thing. Like, it wasn't really majorly plot forwarding, if that makes sense. And I know sometimes that you don't need to move the plot forward to have a good scene, but I was still like, it was one of the more forgetful scenes for me, but I'd like to hear what you guys think of it.
Are you talking about just the initial scene or Tyrion with the dragons as well?
Oh, no, sorry. The initial scene I'm talking about, Tyrion with the dragons, was really cool. But yeah, the initial scene, yeah, sorry. We'll talk about Tyrion with the dragons in a minute.
I mean, I think some of the writing for Tyrion and Varys is a bit off. Just I liked it in general, and like I absolutely loved that they did Tyrion's connection with the dragons. Thought that was brilliant. Like, you know, we get like Quint and Martell in the books, but Tyrion is. I thought that whole scene was like brilliant. I really did.
Well,
dream in the books, doesn't it? And then they just translate that to the show, and I felt like with the dragons, they built it up. This little scene there, this little connection, like that could be signifying he's going to ride a dragon at some point. And I like that as an introduction. I thought some of the banter with Varys was a bit like, it's unnecessary when he keeps talking about his cock and stuff, and he's vegetarian.
I did like that when he leaves the crypt or whatever you want to call it, and he just goes, next time I have an idea like that, punch me in the face. I did like that. I like the lines at the end of each scene. But
my problem with Tyrion at the moment is that like he's such a complex character in the books, and only showing one side to him, the guy that gets drunk. Like, his alcoholism is a big problem. He's a bit more morbid, he's a bit darker, he has dark thoughts, he's aggressive, he's killed his father. Like you look at Jaime and Cersei, and they're going through a traumatic time, and you can really see it, but Tyrion just cracking jokes, oh, he's been buried in the boys. It's like, he's a deeply tormented person. Like, I just think there's more to his character than the show at the moment. I hope that we get to see a bit more of it.
Yeah.
Like, he's dark humour, but as well, he's like, I don't know. It's like, I think the show tends to, with Jon Snow and Tyrion, just really pilot them as his black and white, which is the opposite of George R. Martin. Everyone's great. Like, Tyrion is such a good character, but it does have its flaws and stuff, and they don't really show that as much in the show.
Tyrion's not afraid to make evil decisions. Like,
in terms of
what would normally be deemed good or bad. He's not afraid to make those. Like, he was the one that utilised wildfire at the Blackwater. He wasn't afraid to do it. Do you know what I mean? He said, let's use this to our advantage. I know it's a bit different in the books where he uses, like, a chain and shit, but even in the show, he uses wildfire and takes out whole of Stannis' fleet. That's thousands of men that he happily kills to save the city. So he's not worried about making difficult decisions. But I agree with that whole, at the moment, it's like, he even says the line something like, I drink and I know things, that's what I do, or something, basically. And it was just like, that's a bit too tongue-in-cheek for that character. And it should, I feel like if Varys goes and does something else, that's when we'll get those more, like, when Tyrion's left on his own and he has to make those tough decisions, we'll get more of those reflections. Because I thought they did a good job of that in season 4, where he was like on trial and Shay was betraying him and all this. Like, you got that morbid darkness in that character. Like, he kills his father, he basically calls out the whole of King's Landing, saying like, I don't care about any of you. So we have got that in the past, and I hope we do get that in the future. But just to go on the dragon thing. I really like that scene, and I thought they did it in a way that was relatable to the audience in terms of making it realistic for them. Like, he explains beforehand about their intelligence and how they know things that even humans might not know. And then when he goes down to the actual cellar and unchains them, you don't feel like, oh, this is stupid. How can he talk to them and stuff like that? It's not like the dragon whisperer. They set it up enough for Tyrion to be able to do that without being unrealistic. And I liked his reaction afterwards, like where he basically shit himself, but he kept that calm to keep face. So yeah, that was a good scene, I thought, and sets up.
What do you think, Ryan?
What I said last week about them being Varys and Tyrion, the comic reliefs at the moment, and like what they've, I guess what they had in the last seasons when he was at King's Landing, there were other characters who were having a bit of a better time. Like, so I don't know, you had Arya with the Hound. As soon as things started turning sour for her, things started looking up for Tyrion, and it goes around in circles. There's always someone who's kind of I feel like it's just to keep viewers interested. If everything's morbid,
people
just don't want to. They're not going to want to watch it. It's just going to be horrible to watch. You need to equal it out with a good, happy scene and a bad scene. I mean, I'd be happy to watch a whole morbid, because that's what Game of Thrones is. Everything's morbid. You get a little bit of fun bits with.
It's pretty cruel, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. It's. But I feel like it's just for the TV audience that they have to make at least a little bit of a joke in pretty much every scene. Especially Sir Davos. I remember him.
Yeah, he's become a stand-up comedian this season, yeah. Like, fucking talking about, what was it? What was the meat he was talking about? Mutton?
Yeah, yeah.
Stand-up bit on mutton or something? Yeah, that was a bit strange, but, We'll get on Davos.
Yeah, I've got some stuff to say about Davos, but what do you think of the actual scene of Tyrion and the dragons, Orion?
I've watched it. My dad was watching it, and I watched that scene again, and like in better quality because I watched a rubbish version first. Yeah. And this, as for the dragons, the CG, I don't know if they've changed it since the last season with. What's his name? The one that comes and saves Daenerys.
Drogon.
Yeah, Drogon.
Drogon.
These ones look. I know they've been kept in captivity and that, but they look drastically different to. I don't know if they've purposely done that or if the CG's changed. Or, I just felt like these ones looked more cartoony than the other one. I might have to go back and watch. Watch the one from last season.
I think because it was a minimalistic scene in terms of like it was darkly lit and there wasn't actually much going on in the way of action. They might have half-assed the CGI just to save time and money, but yeah, because it was basically just Tyrion unlocking their chain. Do you know, that was the gist of the scene was freeing the dragons. So. I feel like they might not have put as much effort into the dragon flying and killing men and like you know that action packed scene. So that might have been why.
I don't know if you know the scene like in the scene when it kind of does the close up shot of him pulling out the bar. I don't know if that was like if that was him part CG or not, or if that was actually him pulling it out, because it I couldn't help but feel like. I'm just picking it apart too much now, but that one bit, it just that seemed a bit too CG for me. Like, but it kind of looks weird because he is a dwarf and
wait till he's
our human, so it did look very off. But I think it's just because he is a dwarf and he's supposed to be dragons, so it does fit really. But the scene altogether, like you said, Glenn, I wasn't there going. No, this is unbelievable. This wouldn't happen. They set it up. They explained why the dragons aren't attacking. That he's taking a chance here, and it works. Yeah, I thought it seemed compared to last week's one. This there's actually some essence to this one, whereas the last week's was boring.
In general.
Sorry.
Do you mean in general?
In general, yeah. First, I didn't have a problem with that first bit. I guess the bit about I didn't make any dwarf jokes. It's like, oh, you fought them, you think them, and I'm just like, why is he? Okay, they do dig at each other, Varys and Tyrion, but this is going a bit too far.
I agree that it was a lot better than last week. So I thought it was this episode for me was one of my favourites of all time. To be honest, I really loved it.
I really liked it.
I thought you would hate it because of the Roose death. I don't know that made you angry. But,
that's the thing that I thought. I think that's the only bit in the whole thing that I didn't like, to be honest. The rest of it was absolutely brilliant. I loved it.
It was a pretty solid episode. Yeah.
I really liked it, but I think it's because Daenerys wasn't in it. I have no interest for Daenerys right now. And no interest whatsoever. And
whoa.
She's the main character.
I don't think probably my favourite
character.
What's the actress's name?
Emilia Clarke.
I don't like her. I liked her when she started, but now I just can't stand her. I feel like there's too much acting going on in her. That's possible. There's too much acting going on in her face. Like she's like, I don't know.
So. You're in a bad mood tonight, Ryan, or something. You want dead babies. You want real dragons. You want Emilia Clarke dead. You're not happy. Right, should we move on from Marine then?
Yeah, but just Glenn, how in general, like, what do you rate this episode as?
Probably. I went 7 last week, so I'd have to give this one an 8. But
brilliant.
Yeah, it's a good episode in terms of it was a lot more plot driven than the last episode. Like last episode was basically this is what happened last season. Let's just continue on slightly. This episode was like you got Roose's death. You got can we talk about the Greyjoys now? Because you got the introduction of the Greyjoys, which I actually really liked. I was surprised how well they did it, to be honest.
I found a We Do Not So t-shirt for you. I was looking at that.
Oh, yes. I'll need to get that. I was actually really happy with the Greyjoys part because reading Dance with Dragons, the Greyjoys was probably my favourite parts to read. And any time someone talks about Barriss and Selmy, so like I was really excited to see the Greyjoys this season, even though we've been so marred by Dorne, and I was hoping they weren't going to do a Dorne. They could still go down that road, but I feel like we got a lot this episode. It was a good way to introduce them again. I'll start talking about Baelon and our. Yeah. I love the quote that Baelon says, like, I've won the Battle of the Five Kings. I'm still alive, which, in a way, that's true. He was the only.
In the books, he wasn't.
No, he wasn't. In the show, it worked because, like, he won. He was the one that stayed alive, so technically, he won.
Yeah, why is he the one? Including King of Nothing. That's what the great guys always are. She
immediately says, like, you didn't win. You're sitting here on a rock. Doing nothing. Yeah. So it was that. I like bits of dialogue like that where it's like you see how delusional some characters can be in that world, and how some other characters bring them down to earth. So I thought that was good. But I also really like the introduction of Euron. I thought that scene on the bridge was very like atmospheric and. They somehow got the character of the Greyjoys in the scene, like in the rain and the bridge, and that conversation between the brothers was very, like they did a lot to keep the backstory, but not from it in your head, like give you so much exposition that you're like, oh for God's sake, could they just kill him already? And like in the books, that's only referred to that he was murdered by someone, but
well, in the books, it's just a storm, isn't it?
Yeah, they just think he just fell off a bridge. But there is speculation that he was murdered.
Mm.
And I don't mind too much that the show just outright says, like, Euron's the one that murdered him, because that gives us a good basis to judge that character. You either go one of two ways. You go, ah, he's an asshole, but I don't think anyone really cares about Baelon Greyjoy, so they're not going to think that. Or you go, ah, this guy's cool. He just killed that loser. So I thought it was a great way to introduce it. It was interesting to get like Damp Hair in the episode as well. I didn't think he would be a character really. I just thought he'd be in the background. But it was good to see like he's actually given advice, because in the books he does that as well. He gives advice to what do they call her in the show? It's not Asha.
Yara.
Yeah. For some reason they did that so that people wouldn't confuse her with Arya. But to me, Yara's more confusing than Asha.
Asha, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you thought the Wandering Woman and Asha, people wouldn't be able to handle it.
Oh yeah, that was it. That was it. Yeah, they're so stupid. But yeah. Anyway. Yeah. Overall, the Greyjoys was probably my favourite bit of the episode. So I'd like to get your guys' views on that because I know I love the Greyjoys too much.
Sorry.
Sorry.
What happened? What happened? He was talking over one another.
Oh, sorry.
I'll say, you want to go next, or shall I?
Well, in general, my score for the episode would be a... I'd be really generous with it and be a 9.5. I'd be 9.5.
Yeah! I'm with you, Ryan.
So Ryan goes, the CGI shit, they didn't the fucking, I hate the episode, it's an iPhone, I move.
The episode was really good, but because Daenerys wasn't in it, that you're not going to agree with me on that.
Yeah, I suppose that's a...
I don't want to jump to bits that... I'll mention why I've underscored it that 0.5 later on, but with the Greyjoys, I'm excited to see what they're going to do with that. Especially, how do you talk about one scene and not another? We now know that Theon's going to be on his way there. So,
that's that excites me. I'm interested to see where that character goes now, rather than just like being a lackey basically and doing nothing.
Yeah, is it going to be like a brother sister team up, like double act? They're going to be doing and
you'd like to think that they're going to try and overthrow Euron because it's going to king's going to happen and Euron's going to become king. So that'll be interesting to see. And obviously Asha's going to be pissed off about it. So it'd be good. Sorry, Yara. He's going to be pissed off about it. It would be good. It'd be interesting to see Theon come back, sort of. He's obviously never going to be the same Theon again, but he still comes back and supports his sister. They have that conversation about she tried to save him, and then he finally tells her, look, like, what he's been through and all that. And then, yeah, that would be interesting to see that sort of team up to overthrow Euron. I don't know where it would fit in the overall plot. Like... it would be a strange aside, but I would want to watch it because I love the Greyjoys.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. I can't what, really what say.
Did, what did you think of Euron's introduction?
I thought it was a really interesting way for them to do it because he just kind of came out of nowhere. Yeah, it's like they didn't you know, have Littlefinger there. They didn't have Littlefinger there to go, this is you, Euron Greyjoy. And they're like,
sorry, Tom, just to explain, me and Ryan have been talking about, like, forever, how Peter Baelish is just exposition in the show.
And
every time we see a bit of exposition, we want, like, Baelish to pop up out of nowhere and just give that piece of exposition. So anyway, keep going, Ryan.
The version I watched was a rubbish version on, like, Couch Tuna. So it was, like, it was absolutely
awful. Don't plug illegal websites, Ryan.
I've been sponsored. That you had... what am I saying? That scene was so dark that on the version that I watched, I couldn't really tell what was going on. So I don't know.
Did you think you're on time?
When I saw him, it was like, oh, Theon got there quick. And I was just like, for TV audiences, it was a very brave way to introduce a character that they've done so far.
Brave.
Yeah, and so it was a surprise to see that happen all of a sudden. I thought he was going to walk out of there and then we weren't going to hear from the Greyjoys for maybe another couple of episodes. So it was a surprise to me. That's why I've rated this episode quite high, because it is full of quite a few surprises. And I know we've gone past the books, but there's a lot they could do from the books, but especially the Greyjoys. So really, this shouldn't have been a surprise, but it was, because they've actually done something right.
Yeah. What did you like it, Tom, or?
Greyjoys. By the way, I never knew that you loved the Greyjoys so much.
I love the Greyjoys.
I love that you're so affiliated with someone that's not such a big. I don't know. I just love it. I find it really interesting. We do not so. It's just your kind of guy there. you thought that, like, as well in Dancing Dragons, that was more interesting. I definitely think it was really intriguing in the books, and I think this is one of the things in a show where they just introduce it brilliantly, and I think they did Dawn terribly, but I'm just completely ready for a fresh start in terms of the Greyjoys, and I'm optimistic that they'll do a really good job. I think, I don't know the actor's name, but the guy cast as Euron, I thought was not what I expected at all,
no.
But definitely seemed to have his own kind of interpretation of what the character was in a good way. It seemed really interesting, really dark. Wasn't what, just appearance, I mean, is what, not what I expected, but I really liked him. He had his eye just covered. So there wasn't much, like, he didn't come up and go, "Arr!" he's got the eye patch. But yeah, I really loved the scene. I thought as well, we're kind of wondering, we've been talking about how are they going to introduce them. Like, it seems they've missed them out for so long to just introduce them. It's kind of weird. And I think the way that they did it, I thought, you know, just throw them straight in. They kind of did throw it straight in. But killing off Balon was a good introduction to Euron's character. Yeah. I don't care about the fact that it wasn't explicit in the books, because we only get POV characters anyway. But I thought the show has that freedom, and I thought they did a really good job with the death. I thought it was just really cool. And Balon Greyjoy as well. I've always hated that guy. I loved Euron. And like you said, when you're talking about Euron being badass, I really got the impression of what he's badass, what he's cool. I think that the Kingsmere is going to be very interesting as well. Will it be Danthea, Theon, and Yara all joining together and still losing?
I think that's what's going to happen. Yeah, like you just said.
Yeah, but like you, I'm obviously not as big of a fan as you as the Greyjoys, because even in the books, the introduction comes kind of late. I have to go, oh god, just another story. But I've done like a bit of a turn in the Greyjoys. I'm really quite excited to see what's going to happen. The Dawn, they just fucked it up, and like that's something that I'll never really get over, because Dawn, the passion you have for the Greyjoys is the passion I have for the Dawnish.
Yeah,
basically, apart from the Starks, my favourite house. So you can understand why I was so upset about that. I also loved Arya Martell as a character, but yeah, loved it.
Alright,
you want to move on to that?
Yeah, I think if we're going on introductions, we should do a reintroduction, and we should go to Bran. I really liked this scene as well. This was another great scene. I think they can't really go wrong with going into the past, because that's always going to be good. Everyone wants to see how these characters were young. We get a young Ned Stark, we get a young, what's his uncle's name?
Brandon, Lyanna.
Yeah, we got Lyanna, but what's Ned's brother again?
Brandon,
that's it. And, we got them. They're slowly planting the seeds of Lyanna's character. I think each flashback's going to include her somehow. Which I really hope we get the tourney, where Rhaegar gives the flower to Lyanna, because I think that would be really cool to see. But I think we're going to get it out of order. So we're going to get the Tower of Joy first. And you're like, what's this fight about? Like, for people that don't know about it, and you're going to be like, whoa, what's happening here? Why is Ned fighting the Kingsguard? And then we get the whole reason behind it. So I think that would be really cool. And, yeah, this scene just got me excited for what Bran is going to do. We didn't get too much from Bloodraven. like, there wasn't, it was just sort of that mentor character, but we haven't, we're still not clear on his motives yet. But yeah, I really like this scene, and we also got to see Hodor talk more words than just Hodor, which is really interesting. And now we're getting like loads of crazy theories on why Hodor can't talk anymore. He's like, apparently, I saw one theory about Hodor can't talk because he sees Bran go back in time and they interact with each other, and then that stops Hodor from talking. It's like, I was like, what? This is a lunatic with like a pencil hat on just going, theory. But I really like that scene, and it was good to see sort of that flashback to season one where it was Ned looking over at like Bran and Rob and John and Arya and all that, and now you see Bran looking over Ned and that when he was young, and you sort of get that nice little family tie-in. So yeah, I really like this thing. What do you guys think?
You wanna go, Ryan?
Yeah, it was it was really nice just to be back in Winterfell and it not being all burnt to a crisp with burning child corpses. have we seen this in the book? Has he gone back and like looked at in back in time?
I don't believe so, no.
Because that's why it
in the book he just meets up with Bloodraven and that's where it ends, isn't it?
Yeah. So,
I'm not sure. Is it not?
I think the last line of Bran's last chapter is, "You'll never walk again, but you'll fly." I think that's the last. I think he meets Bloodraven, and that's it. It stops in his part of the book where season four stopped for Bran, as far as I can remember. But yeah. What were you saying, Ryan?
It'll be interesting to see if he struggles with the powers and, like, if he'll walk too much and we'll see him go, I don't know, maybe he'll go blind, like Arya's was blind. Maybe he'll actually go blind and he'll have to walk through people instead. Maybe he'll permanently be walking from person to person and like we'll just have to control Hodor carrying him around. I like that we saw Hodor talking. That was cool. All the young actors were quite good, actually.
Yeah.
Like I wasn't sat there and going, "Oh, this is really cringy." I think I've kind of felt a bit weird with the Cersei flashback in the other season. I felt like that was a little. The casting was good. You could tell it was supposed to be Cersei straight away, but I just felt like it was I don't know, a little too forced. I feel like these kids were quite good with their acting this time around. Did he know the Nan, or there was one bit there where he was reacting to everyone? I'm just picking again.
She shows up. She shows up. Nan, old man shows up. Yeah.
It's. I guess he does a little smile, but he's like, "Oh, there's my dad. There's my aunt. There's my uncle."
She's the one that pulls him away, and Ned says something like, "Oh, if he could fight, it'd be so dangerous." And then she's like, "Yeah, but it's a stable boy, so he's not going to fight."
And then when he comes back and goes and talks to, I always forget her name and her brothers or brother.
Oh, Mira Reed.
Mira. I was a little annoyed with her, but I think you're supposed to be that she's starting to be a bit whiny about just sitting around, not doing much, feeling a bit useless. I feel like that's the attitude Daenerys needs to have, but it isn't given.
Right, don't bash on Daenerys.
Yeah, I'm more rooting for Mira as a female character than I am any of the others. I feel like she's got the one with the most potential right now, other than Arya, maybe.
Mira Reed? The biggest female character, isn't it?
Yeah, because it's like, because she hasn't, that's the thing, she's such an underdog. Like, she's got no special powers, she's got no...
Don't forget, Alan Reed protected Ned Stark back in the day. Same thing could happen. There could be a sword next to Bran's throat, and Mira Reed comes in.
I feel like...
I really like her character as well, but, like, saying she's like, one of the most important. Like, I think we've got so many strong female characters that I really like.
I think it's more of the actors that I don't get along with. I don't like Maisie Williams anymore, ever since Doctor Who.
Do you like the characters in the books, then? Is it just a show?
I think it's a show thing. It's just the actors. Even like Theon, I don't get on much with his scenes. I know you're supposed to. I don't know. Are you supposed to? Do you guys feel bad for people like Theon and that, or do you? I know.
And he's gone.
Right.
Amelia Clark found his internet connection and stopped it. Are you there, Ryan?
Hello.
Yeah, you froze.
Oh, did it freeze?
Yeah.
I thought it had.
All right. What were you saying, sorry?
What I was saying was, I don't know how far you heard me, but Theon, I was talking about Theon, and basically these people, it's like, how do you feel bad for them, or do you feel like they are in the place that they deserve? Like, obviously Theon's free now.
We're going to talk about them later on.
Yeah, fair enough. It's just that what was I saying? The actors. I like the actress that's playing Mira. Like, every time she's been in it, it's been a good scene. Whereas like Dawn, which was primarily taken by female actresses right now.
Yeah, that's a fair point.
They've let us down. So they've let women down.
So he's killing babies. He hates dragons. He hates Amelia Clark, and now he hates women.
I know. I said they've let women down.
No, I just try to put words in your mouth. Anyway, what did you think, Tom, of the Bran scenes?
I really, really liked it. I thought Lyanna riding in the horse, they kind of got that good mix of Lyanna, where she's kind of a mix between Sansa and Arya, where she's got Arya's wildness, but she's really attractive. And she's kind of known as she's beautiful, but you know, she's got that wild side to her.
Tom, are we going to have to put you on a list? No, but I know what you mean. They sort of portrayed her as that, like, sort of, like, the long flowing hair.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
They portrayed her as What's that, sorry?
I agree as well with what Ryan was saying about the actors for the children. I thought Ned, the child, really looked like him, and he had that, you know, kind of a solemn face, but kind of, I don't know, it just really looked like Ned as a kid to me. I thought the casting was brilliant. Definitely agree with Ryan on that. In terms of Bran and Bloodraven, the tone of this, I think they're getting really right as well, which is one of the reasons why I really love this episode as well. Made me really optimistic. I think Bran, the pace that they're going with him is fine. I think because he's stationary, he has not enemies or anything at the moment. As far as we know, he's kind of in this safe haven where he can just discover. There's a lot. It's all just in the mind, and just discovering. He's learning with Bloodraven, and like all these visions, he's just learning about the past. And like, I just think I just love it all so much. I think I wouldn't mind at all if he just got a lot of flashbacks from Bran, yeah. And then as well his progression, because it's not like other characters where things like need to happen, which is maybe something that I know Ryan was saying about. I don't know if you feel about this about Daenerys, but you kind of feel like, oh, come on, do something. She just kind of gets caught up in the politics of the East, which is interesting. But you think, like, in terms of characterization, her whole thing is Westeros. But that, I think, is very different with Bran, because I think he's got a lot of time to grow. And I think when he does make his big move in some way, which, in my opinion, is warging a dragon.
Yeah.
And it might have some connection with the wall. I think he might even, you know, warg a lot of important characters or animals to fight the undead. I think Bran basically is almost on a kind of Lord of the Rings mythical, magical powerhouse. Mm-hmm. Because J.R.R. Martin, looks deceiving with him. You see, Jaime's a renowned warrior, then he loses his hand, and it's like, look how fragile his power was. Robert Baratheon, the most powerful warrior in the whole of Seven Kingdoms, turns into a fighter that ends up getting killed, and etc. What I'm saying is, this looks being deceiving is really a strong thing with J.R.R. Martin. I think, like, with characters. Barriers as well. He seems effeminate. He seems unthreatening. Littlefinger. He likes to build up these kind of seemingly weak characters to yeah. make them really, really strong. And I think Bran is going to be the ultimate form of that, where his mind is what's extremely powerful. I think it's going to be the most heavily magical aspect of it all, because this is fantasy after all.
Yeah.
And I think I think with Bran we've got spectacular things, but I think the build up is all. I'm just loving it at the moment. I've got nothing negative to say at all, and I can't wait for the Tower of Joy scene as well.
Yeah, it looks like we're getting that next episode. So that
really,
yeah, they showed it in the preview. So it looks good.
I can't wait to see that. Yeah. And I think with John being well, we'll get into that.
Okay. So where should we go to next then?
King's Landing, maybe?
Yep, speaking of minds, that guy's mind is now all over a wall. there was two great scenes of wall bashing this episode, and that was one of them with Robert Strong. But like, I like those scenes where you get that sort of characterization of the cities, and that was a great one with King's Landing, where it's sort of like. It's like modern, like London, where it's like this Cockney geezer sort of going, "Oh, I did this with my cock and all that," and then he just gets battered in an alleyway, and it's like that's King's Landing in a nutshell. I saw an interesting thing
well,
about
showing off Bung's power as well. Like,
what he can do. We know already from the mountain, but like you said, we haven't actually seen what Robert Strong can do yet, other than lift Cersei, which, you know what I mean. So yeah, that it was just so brutal, but it was like you couldn't help but laugh at the same time. So it was a pretty cool scene. But with Cersei getting kept into the was it the Red Keep? She was imprisoned basically.
I think she was
in the Red Keep, but yeah, that was like it was kind of interesting to see that. Yeah, it was interesting to see that her powerlessness, but also if she wanted to, she could get out of there because Robert Strong could probably take all those guys. But
big call.
Yeah, I don't know if this was the way they were going with it. And I don't really think that this was the case, but it sort of felt like her just usually she would confront them and just be like, move out of the way, I'm the queen, get out of my way. She sort of just went, ah, oh, fuck it, and went back to her thing and just couldn't be asked. And I feel like that's sort of her deterioration of character in terms of her strength. Like, she's slowly losing her ability to fight, and that could end up with her going into more and more turmoil, getting more and more paranoid about all the things that are happening in King's Landing, and then her ultimate destruction in terms of, be it her actual demise or her insanity, where she basically destroys King's Landing, which is what I think might happen. But moving on from that. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
I was gonna say, I don't think she. I think she turned around not out of like a weakness or her changing in any way. I think it was purely she's only got Tommen left, and if she decides to turn against him, she practically has nothing. So she's got Jaime, but
can I just do an opinion about this specific thing?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I was just going to say I agree with what Ryan's saying on that.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, it was still a very tense scene. Like, you could, the way that that guard, you could tell that he was very nervous.
He did not want to fight that guy at all.
No. It was like, I was just as nervous because I didn't know what she was going to do.
I thought we were going to get a fight scene. That's why it was a good scene, because they teased it and then they didn't give you it. But I like the fact they didn't give you it, because it built the tension more. Yeah. So, and we know I think we're gonna get a later scene like that anyway. So when that happens again, you'll be like, oh, what's gonna happen? You don't know. So that was good.
Yeah. If I've learned anything this season so far in the last two episodes, that they are loving their long scenes of kind of almost like nothing happening. It's a good scene, but like in the last episode, we are only the second one in, aren't we?
Yeah, this is episode two.
Yeah. Melisandre at the end of last one, I just felt like that went on forever. I felt like it was uncomfortable to watch. And you're just, especially if you're watching it with your mum, Glenn.
Yeah.
So it was just like, oh, okay.
I'm straight talking you are, Ryan.
It's just like, okay, please, just stop. But in this sense, it was used correctly. It was like you said, Glenn, it was tense.
Building tension.
I didn't know what was going to happen. But then later on in this episode, that we'll get to later on, they do another waiting around thing, and it's like, we know it's going to happen, just do it already. But
yeah. All right. Shall I talk about the Cersei scene, and then we can all talk about the Jaime scene?
Yeah.
Do it like that. Because there's quite a bit of meat to this thing. Yeah, I thought for the Cersei scene, I agree with what both of you are saying. I thought where he smashes his head against the wall, I just thought that was so cool. It was a great just display of his strength. It was instantaneous. And I agree with what you're saying, Glenn. It did have that, even though it was such a brutal thing, it was kind of funny. I don't know if it was intentional, but for me, I noticed a comedic element.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I really like that. In terms of, I agree with what Ryan's saying. I think her character at the moment is just taking a step back. I think she's lost so much and everything's been so headstrong. You see, she was fiery and everything like that. At the end of Dance of Dragons 2 with Kevin Lannister, that's what she's like, where Kevin's like unnerved by how, you know, meek she's become, and she's kind of just been very pleasant and stuff like that. And I think that's mirroring the show at the moment. Whichever way they're going to go with that, I know me and you, Glenn, are under the impression that she's literally losing her mind. And I think there's some symbolism within it, with the show, to reference that with this.
Sorry, go ahead. I think you're going to say it anyway.
Go on.
Where she's like pulling out the thread of her clothes.
Yeah. Did you think that as well? That was kind of the unhinging of her mind.
It's her breaking at the seams. Basically, she's like, piece by piece, she's getting slowly demoralized.
Because what Ryan was saying about she, like, it wasn't the case of that she was just giving up. She was like just starting to kind of take a step back and think about Tom and him. But at the same time, I agree with what you're saying, is she is coming in unhinged, and I think the pacing of that is also, this is why I love the episode so much. I think they got a lot right. I think the pacing is very good, so that Cersei's meltdown or burning of the say whatever, I think it's going to be a slow progression and a deterioration.
Yeah.
And I think for it to just start going crazy like that at the moment wouldn't be as good. But that's why I like the scene so much.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm sure you two have got plenty to say on the Jamie and High Sparrow scene. So.
Well, the biggest quote from that was something along the lines of, we can overthrow an empire. So he's kind of just put his cards on the table with that one. Like, he's outright said that he wants to overtake King's Landing to a Kingsguard, which I think is like the ballsiest thing a character's done in the show, maybe in the history of the show. So that was a really good scene to sort of show how helpless the Lannisters and you could say Baratheons, but they're not really anymore, have become in their own city. They're sort of under siege, but slowly and surely with the Sparrows coming in. Like, I like the fact that Jaime Lannister still sort of did his little quip, and he was like, I could take down about 8 of these guys. And then he's like, yeah, you could kill me before they're going to take you down, but you will go down. And I like that sort of the High Sparrow being a martyr thing. I don't think he wanted to die, but he still does that whole thing. He keeps face in front of his people so that they'll follow him more. Like, if those Sparrows see their leader stand up to the Kingsguard, there's no reason why the whole lot of them can't stand up to the Kingsguard. So, yeah, I really like that scene of that. And it also, with Jamie's character, it showed how, like, he doesn't give a shit about religion and all that. Like, he's willing to shed blood in the whatever the sept, the holy sept or whatever. But yeah, it was interesting to see. Like, I thought that was a good way to show how powerful the Sparrows have become, and that was the main thing I got from that scene. What do you think, Ryan?
Sorry, I am paying attention.
That's right.
Sister's asking for a lift. I wasn't listening. Did you say anything about the theory, though, of... I've forgotten his bloody name now. Connell's theory of the Iron Bank being involved.
The Iron Bank?
Yeah, I didn't.
Yeah, I'm not confirming that I believe that theory. Look, but if it works out that's the case...
It would.
I'm confirming that I definitely don't believe that theory.
It would be interesting, but yeah, I doubt it still. But it does make you wonder, where are they getting all of this power? Obviously, they've just been handed it from Cersei because she thought it was a good idea to get one up on Margaery. But I know they are in charge pretty much, but because he handed it over to them, but surely there's something they can do. I know they've only got really got the Kingsguard to do anything with, but surely they control an army as well.
Yeah, but I feel like, as far as I know, that army isn't totally well numbered. I think they used up a lot of the resources in the battle for the Five Kings. So,
and the Lannisters are there.
Yeah, exactly. The Lannisters took their army to the Westerlands, didn't they? So
yeah, they're dealing with Edmure and the Blackfish.
Yeah, yeah.
So they don't have a standing force at King's Landing.
They're
on the floor, so.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, they are outnumbered, I think, in their own city, especially by, if you think about it. If he's managed to get all the peasants on side, then that's a lot of people in that city that are willing to fight against, you know, the king's army. So, and it's not even a king's army; it's like a few hundred men that are guarding the wall. So, yeah, I can see how they're capable of overthrowing that city. Yeah, did you have anything else to say on that, Ryan?
It was a good scene to show their power. We do know of the Sparrow's power. Like, what they've done to Cersei is enough to prove it. But I think a lot of people kind of assumed Jaime would come back, see what they'd done, and just fucks you up, but they have. He hasn't. He can't. It's been proven to people now that's why he can't do it. I was wondering myself why they hadn't done anything. Why he hadn't done anything yet. I felt like that would have been one of the first things he'd have done. It was a good scene. I don't really have much to say about it.
All right, fair enough.
I liked Jamie's interaction with Tommen, because again, it's like there's that father son relationship with one of them not knowing, and it's like it's kind of nice to be that's on the side that knows, and that every time they've interacted. Him with any of the children, it's like oh, but you don't know he's your dad. And, I feel like it will never come out though, to top. Or do you think he knows? Because I don't think it will ever come out to any. Well, it can't come out to the others now.
Well, Marcella said she knew, but I think that's because she was a bit cleverer than Tommen, to be honest. But
older also.
And older, yeah. So she sort of had an inkling, but I don't think Tommen will ever find out. Really, like he thinks he's a Baratheon.
Inconsequential.
It doesn't matter. It would be good. It would maybe be good for Jaime's character to get that monkey off his back, but it doesn't really. In terms of Tommen's character, I don't think it would change his perspective too much.
Yeah.
He might even Tommen's such an idiot that he might even like go, "Oh, I'm not a Baratheon. I'll relinquish the crown or something stupid." So it might be worth Jaime not telling him that he's the father. So yeah. What did you think, Tom?
Just as both of you brought up some points that I've not thought of when I first watched it. What you just said then made me just start thinking about the future of events. When you talk about Tommen relinquishing his crown, I think that this scene left a lot. It left a lot of paths that it could go down. I think the scene was very interesting, and it was kind of. I agree with what you're saying, Glenn, about this. High Sparrow plays his hand somewhat. I mean, overthrow an empire. I think that means a lot, also. But I think the numbers of men you were talking about earlier on as well. I'm not really sure.
Yeah.
I mean, the gold cloaks we know from Game of Thrones, book one, that they can be bought. And there's quite a lot of talk of them being 3,000 strong.
Okay.
They've also got good weapons and spears and whatnot. So in terms of like if it came to bloodshed, I think that the show is left that deliberately ambiguous.
Yeah.
But like there's a lot of paths that can go down. I thought the dialogue between Jaime and the High Sparrow was very interesting. Like he played his hand out. Yeah. And I felt like I predicted something similar, by the way, to this ages ago when I was basically Brotherhood Without Banners. I predicted that the working class, or this is kind of the working class with the peasantry, but it's also got a religious background with, you know, the High Sparrow. It's both basically.
I think.
George R. R. Martin is very, very clued up on history. And I think there's a lot of symbolic implications here. I think it could be in terms of overthrow empire. They could go with that. They could not. It could be like the French Revolution, basically.
Yeah.
The Lannisters are nobles. They're overthrown, and we see a new order. And I don't know what, how much time we have for things like that, but I think, prediction, that the High Sparrows overthrow the nobility in King's Landing. I think they're going to do it. I think that they're powerful enough now. I think the small folk are fed up of the nobles and the feudalistic system where they're just taking... It's so brutal. Like it, I don't even... I think like Martin's world is probably even worse than it was in reality. Not sure about that, though. But it, they're on a similar level of just how atrocious the small folk get treated. And I think that, you know, he's brought them together now, the High Sparrow, and I think he's got a good cause. He did, what he was saying about, you know, I'm indispensable, and it's that kind of, they have the numbers, they have the motive, the sick of the world. Look how much, they're the ones that get hurt. The small folks are the ones that get hurt the most, the ones that get hurt the most from the wars, where Gregor Clegane's going raping and pillaging the land, and, you know, he talks about maidens that have talked about being raped by Stark men and Lannister men. And all this, they're the ones suffering so much from their heart. When Varys is in season one, when you High Lords play your Game of Thrones. And I think that it'd be brilliant, I'd absolutely love it, if they went that way. And the High Sparrows, I don't, they have the cloak of the religion, which I talked about that to you last week again, about how just, how like, immoral, not immoral, sorry, misguided, maybe.
Yeah.
The faith are, and their way of doing things is kind of just this kind of crazy religious sect. But I do like the clash between the wealthy and the poor. And I think if they played on that, and I think they've got some room to do it, I really would like to see them go that way.
Yeah.
So I also thought as well, you talk about Tommen relinquishing his crown. I think that's a possibility. When he was talking to both Cersei and Jaime, and he was so unsure of himself, and he was like, well, you know, I want to be strong for you.
Yeah, he basically can't do anything. Like, he was helpless. So
he's impressionable, but I think at the same time we could see, like, look, we get Joffrey, he was absolutely terrible, and Tommen could be a redemption of that. He could save the Lannisters in some way by, I don't know, agreeing to something with a high faith. Well, you know, he talks about Cersei being strong. It's also Tywin's trying to teach him how to be just as well, and sometimes maybe he'll step down, he'll acknowledge that they've lost the power, and he'll step down in some form. Whoever, it could be to the faith, it could be, regardless. But yeah, I think that whole scene is showing a big shift in the balance of power. All in the early seasons, we see Lannister's shit gold, and Tywin Lannister's such a powerful figure. Yeah. And just like Cersei, the Lannisters are just get weakening, and that was shown in the scene. I also thought, you said, Glenn, you said about Jaime says, oh, I can cut eight of you down.
Yeah.
That's a bluff, as it is.
I know he couldn't have done that. But he still also said, like, oh, I could kill you before they get to me, which is true. But yeah, I know he did. He didn't want to fight. I know that. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with what you're saying. And that, and I think he knew that. And I think the scene as well showed it in his eyes. You could see when the house, he was nervous, Jaime, then. He was like, they might just kill me, yeah? You know, the only reason they don't is because of spilling blood in a holy place and whatnot. But
yeah.
Yeah, I think my main point is that I think that they've really left a lot of paths open to go with that, and
right.
Hard to predict.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of the paths that they can go down with, I'll be happy with.
Yeah,
I wouldn't be surprised if what we were saying about Cersei being not one to lose, it kind of quickly changes in that scene where he comes back and apologizes to her. It's like when they do the almost kind of cliche hug where she kind of doesn't really do a grin. I feel like that's exactly what she wanted. She wanted him to come to her and be like, I need help, help me, so that she can get her hand around, like, pretty much around the, like, the crown. Like, she's gonna have some power now, and I feel, I wouldn't be surprised if she slips up somehow and Tommen takes the blame for her with the sparrows, and he basically, I wouldn't be surprised if he is actually executed for some sort of crime by the sparrows when it was actually Cersei's doing, and like she's, I think that will break Cersei.
And that's, who do you, when still be executed, Ryan?
Tommen, via Cersei. I feel like Cersei would, now that Tommen's gone to her and asked for help, I feel like Cersei will, she's gonna try and like spin her web around spin her usual web of lies and that, and try and manipulate people, and like basically what she was trying to do with Joffrey, try and actually be the queen when he was the king. I feel like, yeah, she's gonna fuck up somewhere. Tommen's gonna take the blame. The sparrows will have to end up executing. They'll end up executing him right in front of her, and there's nothing she's gonna be able to do. And then it's gonna break her, and I think it's gonna break Jaime as well. If he's still in King's Landing, he might not even see it. He might be up north.
What are your predictions then? What do you think, Glenn? Because I know in the predictions.
That's actually an interesting point that I've never really thought of, about Cersei trying to manipulate Tommen again. The impression that I got of that scene was sort of like what you were saying earlier about her having Tommen, and she's just holding on to that last bit of the prophecy, basically, that she just doesn't want it to happen so much that she's just happy to sort of be around him and still see him alive. Yeah. So I didn't really think too hard about that interaction, but
I think she's gonna be careful still. Don't get me wrong, yeah. She's gonna be careful and like be very subtle, but yeah. She's gonna slip up somewhere, I think.
Yeah, no, I like that idea, because what you were saying about Jaime just going back. As far as I know, he does actually leave King's Landing this season. Mm. So
where are you getting that information from?
Sources. I watch a lot of trailer breakdowns where they do it frame by frame, and they show like this is clearly Jaime Lannister. Like there's a scene with Brienne and Pod, and it's got the Tully banners behind it. So that's why I think they're going to the Riverlands. But I think we are going to get that scene with Cersei asking for help and Jaime rejecting it. And I think that might be the way that sort of, because Jaime's not there to support her and she sort of breaks down and all that, that might end up in Tommen's demise, like through her paranoia and her lack of control, that will end up with Tommen being unable to control her and somehow... I don't know, like the Faith taking over King's Landing and sort of either subjugating him from the throne or just killing him altogether. So that's where I see Tommen's fate. But I like that idea of Cersei sort of trying to regain bits of her by digging her claws into Tommen. But it'd be interesting to see what happens when Margaery comes back as well, because
influence
over Tommen. So,
feel like...
I think that the Faith would be willing to just kill Tommen, and you think the justification would be that he's born of incest?
If they can spin that story, then yeah, they've got every justification to execute him. But I don't think it's going to be an outright execution, because a lot of lords and houses would still rally to the king, so it would be shooting themselves in the foot somewhat.
But just to get this right, both of you think that the Faith would be willing to execute Tommen just on kind of flimsy grounds, or on the grounds that he's born of incest.
I don't think the High Sparrow would. I think his... this is my prediction for the High Sparrow. He thinks he's in control of his own extremist army.
Yeah.
That'll bite him in the ass. They'll get so extreme that they finally be through his...
They'll join ECW.
What?
They'll join ECW.
They're so extreme. Yeah, ECW. They'll just... It'll end up them killing him. And I think their extremist views could be Tommen's fate as well, where it's like you said, they see him as an incestuous king. And
just evidence what you're saying. You just made me think of something. Like, just evidence towards that end, which I don't agree with, by the way. But
yeah, that's fine.
The High Sparrow seems more level-headed than some of his minions, specifically the kind of indoctrinated Lancel. And also, the scepters, it doesn't show the beating exactly, I don't think, but she's smacking Maja around a bit.
Yeah.
And she says, the High Sparrow says something, I know she can be overly zealous. So I think both of them, subtle indications, definitely evidence your point. Mm. Yeah. Carry on.
That's all I think about that. I just think the High Sparrow is basically, he knows how to play the game, and his agendas aren't religious at all. They're more about gaining power. He is a different Baelish, if you know what I mean. Like he knows how to twist and sort of get power out of nowhere, and I think that'll bite him in the ass.
My interpretation, I've talked about the Faith in general and what their aims are, but I think the Sparrow is misguided. I think he's pious and
really?
To a fault.
Right.
Like, reminds me of in some African countries where they're burning small girls because of witches or something like that.
Yeah.
And that kind of thing where this is really hard to kind of get into, but they believe what they're doing is right. No matter how evil and misguided we think they are, they believe what they're doing is right, and that's what I think. I don't think the High Sparrow is little thing at all. I don't think he's a game player. I think he's willing to enforce by any means possible his interpretation of his religion, and he's like the old kind of Catholic Church of the Crusades, and I think he's on that level rather than he's manipulating his word and he's using it as a device. I think he does believe in what he's doing, but I think he's just misguided.
Okay.
What do you think about that, Ryan?
I like that he's so. He comes across as very arrogant and stubborn in the way that Jamie did, the Hound, all of these kind of these strong male characters that have got their muscles and their brawn to fight, whereas he is a I wouldn't compare him to Littlefinger. I'd compare him to Cersei, the way that he's got everyone else to do his dirty work. That basically Cersei and him are in the same boat. The only way they can control is by manipulating others. And I guess that's why it was so sweet to see Cersei get her comeuppance from him. See him confront you said earlier, where he was so kind of taken aback by being spoken to by someone in some like who's old in rags. I hope that I feel like a lot of people hate this character because of that, because he comes across so arrogant and. and so keen of himself. But I really like this character. I really like the actor as well. I can't think of his name, but I've seen him in a few other things, and I really like him. But yeah, I'm hoping to see him cutting off Tommen's head at some point.
you just want to see the world burn, don't you, Ryan? You're a evil baby puppy Tommen killer. But should we move on from King's Landing now? Because I feel like we covered that in depth. So
I agree with what you're saying about the acting, though, Ryan.
Mm.
Yeah, he's definitely a good actor.
Yeah.
It's so good that we've got three different opinions on him, which is the best way a character should be, is that everyone should have a different reflection of him.
I hate it. It reminds me of, I've been reading about kind of these religious pious figures and stuff like that in fiction and history like that. And he just reminds me of all of them, and I hate hypocrisy and
God,
he reminds me of them, and I honestly, he's one of my least favourite characters. In terms of, I think his character's really interesting, and the actor that plays him is really interesting. But in terms of just like and dislike, I despise him.
I
won't get into my atheism.
Should we talk about Arya, or?
Yeah.
Or just, yeah? Okay. Go ahead, Tom, you can kick us off then.
Oh, me first. All right. I don't have that much to say on Arya. To be honest, I thought that I think that we're going to see a shift in gear, and I think she's going to speed up. And I think now, you know, we've got to be in a blind beggar and whatnot, and he says you're not a beggar anymore. And I think we're going to see some assassinations, and just like Meryn Trant, I thought that was really cool the way they did that, and I hope that carries on. And I just really can't wait to see Arya kind of become this really badass assassin before realizing who she really is. But that's way off anyway. I think,
We'll do an Arya-specific podcast one day.
But in terms of where she is at the moment, I think the pacing has been a bit slow, but I'm still fine with it. Like, I think next episode she's going to kill someone, and I hope they do it really cool. And I think especially in the show, as opposed to the books, I've read a preview chapter for Winds of Winter, and because there's so many characters in the books, she can murder people who are just faintly connected, and book readers will be really interested in that. But the show has to appeal to such a wider audience, and that audience, like, I don't know how to put this kindly, but bit more fickle, a bit more unintelligent, let's say. Because, come on, show watchers compared to readers. Readers are just generally more intelligent. They like the subtle things a bit more. So I think the point I'm getting is, in the show, it has to be someone quite important to it.
Mm.
So I think that her assassination will be a very important character. That they probably will introduce it up as well, because, you know, people... to be fair, to purely show watchers, it's a lot harder for them to know what's going on. That's why you was talking about, you know, this was like, oh, what happened last season? I think that is because a lot of people are like, who's Bran? Do you know what I mean? It's harder for purely show watchers, and they have to do it in a very different way. The time is a lot more limited.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think her next assassination will be someone important.
Ryan?
I liked that Jaqen finally... Is it Jaqen? I got that right?
Yeah.
Jaqen. That he finally shows his face. And out of curiosity, because I can't recall seeing it, there must be at least one scene where they've been both together, but Jaqen and that girl that keeps coming back and hitting Arya.
They did that thing last season, didn't they, where Jaqen swallows the poison and then he dies, and then she turns around and the waif is Jaqen.
Yeah.
So It's sort of like the character doesn't really exist. It's just like who's wearing that face.
Yeah, that's all I'm really curious about those scenes is it actually him or?
I think they're sort of the same person. It's just like it's just different ways, techniques of how to train these assassins. I think is using different. Faces.
I mean, it's a kindly old man, but I really like what they're doing in the shows, that they're a bit more cut to it. And what I was just saying then about there aren't as many characters, I think making it Jacken's just a good thing to do. It's familiar.
Yeah.
He has a voice, and a man must know and a girl must know. I really like him as a character as well. Yeah. I love to see him brought back in the show. And I think whether it actually is him, to me anyways, not important.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. I feel the same. It wouldn't surprise me if they did it in the show where it's just like he's basically everyone in the faceless organization. Like it's just one guy who just keeps changing his face, and that's how it. But he trains people across the world of whatever. So yeah. What were you?
I feel like it will be too sweet. So in the book when. When Sam is in Braavos, there's not much interaction between him and Aya, at all. I think there's not like.
I remember being really confused about that reading it because it was like they were talking to each other, and they were referencing things that they both knew about, but neither referenced who they were. It was really I remember it being really confusing reading it, and I had to read it like back again to sort of get what was going on. But
talking about the books with Aya and Sam.
Yeah, interaction where they bump into each other. Yeah, I think we're gonna get that this season, but I think it's gonna be the same thing where like they don't know each other, so it's like they don't really.
Sam this season.
No, we haven't seen him yet. I think he'll be introduced in Braavos. So.
Really?
I think it will be too sweet of a scene. Like there'll be too much what's the word? Like
fan service.
Yeah. Like they're gonna interact a lot more than they did in the book. Just because if they don't, that'll be kind of cool because it will be like when you read in the book, it's like this is your
yeah, you both know John.
Your best friend. Yeah, this is your best friend's sister. Like,
love John as well.
Yeah, they both love John. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Actually, the two closest characters to John, I'd say.
Yeah, definitely.
So, but I think now, actually, if they decide to follow the book, it kind of makes sense because Aya's kind of come to terms with the fact that she's no one, that she's gotten rid of Aya.
Aya's show stuff is some of the closest stuff to the book. They haven't veered away too much. Like, they've done a good job of actually like everything how I imagined, like the faceless men and like their little the House of Black and White and stuff like that. They've done that to how I see it in my mind on the show, which is kind of, it's the one thing I can never complain about because they've done it really well, I think.
I think elements of it are even better in the show than they are in the books, which is something that I don't say often. But
it's really hard to visualize, especially when they're changing faces. The description's really strange, like they make an incision in their face and stuff like that. Like, I didn't really get the whole logistics behind it, but they've done it really well in the show where it's like they don't over-explain it and they sort of just have it as that mystical, because they're supposed to be like a secret organization, so to keep most of how they work secret and ambiguous is the best way to go about it, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
We learn as Aya learns, basically. So.
Yeah, I feel in the book, that scene with, like you said, you was a bit confused for the whole Sam and Aya thing. I think like it's been explained quite well in the show. She's gotten rid of her past. She's no longer gonna be Aya.
Yeah.
So when they do interact, there's gonna be no purpose for them to actually talk to one another. Like And it's going to be gutting to see, which is going to be really, it's going to be a really nice scene because you're going to just be, you're going to be shouting, find yourself like, shouting at the TV.
Yeah, it'll sort of be like those scenes we got earlier when like Sansa sort of, they're so close but yet so far, like Brienne and Sansa, yeah, when we got that earlier. I think it'll be a similar sort of theme to that where it's like, they're so connected but yet have no idea, yeah. So it's like they're just going to not
comment. By the way, what are your two predictions for Arya's arc this season, just this season in the show?
I think, like you said, we will get some sort of an assassination. I'm not too sure how major the character is going to be, but it's going to be a recognizable character. I have no real prediction who. I'm trying to think where these characters are and where they're going. But yeah, she's basically going to train a bit more, sort of Jedi style. Learn how to be an assassin. I don't necessarily think we're going to get a murder next episode, but we will get it eventually. And I think, like you said, she'll get to the stage where she's got all those abilities, and then she'll find herself again and realize her actual goal, which is to kill all these people on her list. So, yeah.
Do you think the first assassination will be someone she knows then? Like someone that she's going to struggle?
No, because I feel like we've already got that. Yeah. Oh, maybe. Yeah, it'll be someone that's not on her list, but someone she's bumped into in the past.
I don't know, because
I'm trying to think who's actually going to Braavos for any reason, or if they actually send her back to Westeros or Essos or whatever. So I'm not 100%.
What if it turns out that the Hound, that theory is true, and
what, she's sent to kill him?
She's sent to kill the Hound, and then she's just like, oh,
but
no.
Why though? Why did the Faceless Men want to kill him?
I don't know. Don't people come to the Faceless Men as like pretty much like hitmen? Like they give a life life.
They're very expensive assassins.
Yeah, yeah. So.
But if nobody even knows the Hound's alive, then who's gonna?
That's what I was thinking. Like Robert Strong suddenly learns how to speak, and he goes, "The mountains, the Hound's still alive. I know it. Get the Faceless Men." But I feel like you're on the right steps of like, we might get a character that she's conflicted about killing, and that she actually goes through the act of killing them, because that's how she completes her training.
I think that worked really well. Yeah, I agree. That someone who she's conflicted about would bring an extra element to it. I agree. I like that idea.
But I can't think of who. Like, I have no idea what character they could use that wouldn't.
Maybe Tyrion makes his way back over that way. Or she kind of, does she hate Tyrion, or does she get on with him?
He's not on the list.
Initially, Winterfell, I think that was it.
Yeah.
Who knows?
I don't think it'd be enough to make her conflicted about it, to be honest.
Yeah, I think true.
I think she'd kill Tyrion with the blink of an eye, like she doesn't care.
Yeah.
That's. I like that idea of that conflicted assassination. But yeah, I think that's where her story arc goes, and then she'll try and head back to Westeros at the end of the season, I think.
Alright. Have we got anything else left apart from the meaty stuff at the wall?
There's just that one Sansa theme, but I am not worried about talking about it because I don't think really much happened other than Brienne saying, oh yeah, I bumped into Arya, and Sansa going, okay. It's like she doesn't go, wait, we're like, let's go find her. Come on, it wasn't that long ago. But oh well.
Yeah, I never thought about it like that. But did you notice as well that Brienne says like she was with a man, and the Hound and Sansa are pretty familiar with each other.
Yeah,
and Bran knew the Hound as well, and I just found it weird how she admitted the fact that it was the Hound. She just said, "I was."
Yeah, Brienne might not have. She did. She say it's the Hound? She doesn't, does she?
That's the weird part, because Bran says like, "I was with a man. that were trying to protect her and whatnot. And it, both of them knew the Hound.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know, Glenn, you're probably aware of the Sansa and Hound, like, theories about them getting together.
Well, yeah, I feel like the impression that I got from reading the Hound bits was that there was a bit of, like, he cared for her in a total, like, patriarchal sense.
But oh, really? You don't think some sexual
No, I feel like there was some sexuality involved with it as well. I feel like he did, like, sort of fancy her a bit. So
I think he definitely fancied her.
Yeah, yeah. It's that Beauty and the Beast thing, isn't it, really?
Yeah, but he's like, depicted as a beast. But he's one of the only ones that doesn't beat her.
Yeah.
He could have raped her, and he didn't. I'm saying that, like, what a guy.
In Game of Thrones, that's a legitimate thing.
That's a completely different setting. And when the Bloods up and the Warriors and all throughout history, it's not an unusual thing at all, and it's probably not even seen as immoral. It's just kind of seen in them medieval terms as one of them things. And yeah, I think
after party to a battle.
Yeah, it's like the Hound's depicted as a monster, but he isn't. He's, you know, like, he is great. I'm not saying that he's the nicest guy in the world, but you know what I mean. He's got a lot better morals than the vast majority.
He's the only one that treats the world with reality. He's the only one that says, look, all things are
killed. Yes, held his fire when he was fought. But what was we talking about? The Sansa, Brienne. I thought that the Sansa from Beyond scene was quite touching.
Yeah.
You were talking about this earlier, about Theon joining up with the Greyjoys. I think that's definitely an interesting aspect, and I'm really curious to see what his role in that will be as well.
Yeah,
because we've got Euron, he's going to win that, but I could maybe see Theon and Yara reminiscing in a very pleasant way, and they end up trying to plot to I don't know whether it'll work or not, trying to plot to bring down Euron Greyjoy, and that'll be an extra plot twist.
Well, technically, Theon has the right to the
Iron Islands.
Yeah, the Iron Islands. So,
yeah. Well, they're not going to give a shit about that.
No, I was going to say, my prediction seemed to always end in someone's death, but I feel like he's just going to show up and go, "Hi guys," and then like.
What's that?
Do you think Theon will even make it to the Iron Islands?
Good point.
Ramsay's...
It'd be
a bit harsh for him to get caught by Ramsay again, but...
I wouldn't... A bit harsh is the understatement of the century. John Greyjoy has got worse treatment than anyone else by far. Like, you see him as a mumbling wreck, and I love his redemption act. Like,
I always thought his thing was going to be that he sacrifices himself for the greater good, and that's the overall thing.
Right,
but if he goes back to the Iron Islands, I don't see that happening.
He says he's going home, but where is he actually going? I don't know if he's going back.
True as well. Does he even identify that as home? But I was just going to say, I think. He went through. What was he saying?
No, I was going to say something stupid, but I was saying, what if he goes to Winterfell? But they just came from Winterfell, didn't they? They're completely ignored.
Just did a daring escape. He just goes back into Ramsay's arms, like, I'm sorry.
It wouldn't be surprising, but
that would actually be an interesting idea of how much Theon has been demoralized, that if he just helped Sansa escape to slowly redeem himself and then just went straight back to Ramsay to get.
No,
I'm not saying that's what's going to happen, but.
it reminds me a bit of Severus Snape from Harry Potter series. He's such, in my opinion, he's one of the most interesting characters, and I think. As well, do you know when. This is really random, but when Harry's talking about Snape being the bravest man he ever knew, because the Matty Pope with his wig ball about company all the time when he was actually good at whatnot. I think that Theon, to go through what he went through,
yeah,
and still have the bravery to not only help Sansa escape, you know, fight them men, and like his redemption arc to me is just such a brilliant storyline. Like, yeah, that shows bravery beyond anything we've ever seen, in my opinion.
Yeah.
In the whole thing. To go through, it's also a long time that he's been tortured, raped, and mutilated for. To come back from that in any sense, to me, it just, like, defines heroism. We will go into the war. I know we've been at it a while, but...
Yeah, no, okay.
I just want to hear what you two think is going to happen to Sansa. I mean, I know she's going to the war, but me and you talked about this, Glenn, but maybe I just wanted to hear what Ryan has to think is going to happen to Sansa.
I'll admit, I haven't really thought about it. Being with Brienne, it will be interesting to see if they do the... I've forgotten what they call her after her death, but the Catelyn Stark, to actually have her mum come back.
It's still not.
Yeah, that'll be interesting. But I wouldn't be surprised, I think you guys have said it before, if they're going to completely get rid of that and just have Sansa as the replacement for Lady Stoneheart.
That was my theory anyway. I don't know if that's actually...
Wasn't your theory that Sansa would become Lady Stoneheart?
Well, not that she, like, die and come back to life. She will just be the ruthless character that hangs all the Freys and gets revenge, that sort of...
Yeah.
She'll have her plot, but not her...
I think Sansa... Lady Stoneheart is basically devoid of morality, and she's just all about retribution, and she's the treatment of Brienne's just completely unreasonable. I think Sansa, I don't think Sansa's just going to be this kind of revenge figure.
Right, fair enough, yeah.
I think it's possible. But...
Yeah.
If they actually do that to Sansa, like actually... literally kill her and then bring her back.
I don't think they're going to do that. I don't.
It'll be a long shot if they do.
Yeah.
But I mean, if they do, it would be annoying just because.
He's one of my favorite characters.
It'll become too much of the norm that these people are just being brought back from the dead.
Yeah. I agree.
These red priests and priestess. I don't know where she's. I hope she makes it to the wall. I don't think there's.
I don't think she ends up at the wall. I think she goes in the opposite direction towards the Riverlands. But that's just my opinion.
Yeah, I agree with you there, Glenn. I think her going to the wall, where now we see Jon's resurrected and he's that kind of patriarchal power. I think her place at the wall would be so kind of secondary, she wouldn't be doing anything. I think in terms of her progression as a character, I'd really like to see her take on authority of some kind, whether that's, I know you talked about this as well, Glenn, meeting up with the Northmen, or my... Yeah. So, we haven't seen I could talk about Littlefinger forever, but I'm not going to do that, because I've ran it on too much. But regardless, I don't think her place is at the wall, and I think that she's got whatever form it takes, whether it's a Northern Lords or Littlefinger, or I really like to see her character. I think she's had enough manipulation and abuse and from Joffrey and Ramsay. In my opinion, I will be very annoyed if anything else but her ruling, her learning, her developing in a very strong sense the rest of the season. If that doesn't come to fruition, I'll be very annoyed, because Sansa's basically my favourite. Actually, I have so many favourite characters, but in a way, Sansa's my favourite characters.
Yeah, fair enough.
Female characters.
Should we go to the wall if Sansa's not, then?
Yeah, the last one now.
All right, can I just talk about what we talked about earlier, Robert Strong, is it?
Yeah.
We talked about head smashing.
let's do this in two parts. Do the first part, and then everything else, you talk, Glenn, then you, Ryan, then me, and then we'll all talk about the resurrection.
Okay. What, just spoiler?
Meat to it, that's all.
Yeah, okay, right. I'll start on the Wildlings then. We sort of knew what was going to happen. The Wildlings, like, I don't know what Alistair Thorne's main plan was. Like, before this happened, it made sense. But then when the Wildlings come through the wall with a giant, you just go, what were you thinking? What was your plan? Like, I don't understand what his plan was. But like, he's supposed to be like this wily, you know, hard, battle-hardened northern guy that's been at the wall for like 30, 40 years, and he knows tactics. So this tactic that he kills the Wildlings' main link to the wall, and then doesn't expect some sort of like fight back. It's like, I know he hates the Wildlings and he probably wants to fight the Wildlings, but there'd be a better way of doing it than making them angry and fight back. So, but it was a cool scene just purely for that, the giant grabbing the guy and just smashing him across the wall. I was just like, that was another one that I just burst out laughter, but not because it was like ha-ha funny, it was just like shocking funny, like I just couldn't believe what I saw, but it was cool. But yeah, I don't really have much opinion on the actual overall context of it. I just thought it was, one, Alistair Thorne's seems stupid in that scene, and two, it was just, it was cool to see the Wildlings do their Wildling thing.
Again, though, Ollie decides to charge at them, and like, I'm there in shock how stupid this kid seems. Like,
oh come on, both his parents were killed by the Wildlings.
Yeah, to be fair, that's it. This is the first time I actually thought Ollie was like. It was the first time I thought he was just acting purely off emotion. Like, he's seen these Wildlings come in through the wall. They just smashed a guy's head across a wall, and he's just like, "I fucking hate these guys!" Ah, and he is young and doesn't have a clue. So I can understand his like lack of thought going into his actions. But yeah, go ahead.
But I guess it kind of shows. It's almost like a symbol of. Of everyone's thoughts on the Wildlings below the wall. Everyone's acting like children. They just think that, oh, they're Wildlings, they're bad. The stories are that they're bad guys that come and kill. It probably even turned out that his parents weren't killed by the Wildlings. Might have just been.
They were.
That's what we
heard.
No, we saw them
murdered. What?
We literally saw them
murdered. Oh,
the Bolton guy. He raised their villages and killed his parents. Ollie's the only survivor.
He keeps Ollie alive just to tell the wall how bad it is. That's brutal.
Well, I'm really hoping that. He's one of the kids that I just don't like. I just don't like in this show because another person who just comes across as so arrogant, but he's a kid. Like, why? What right does he have to act like that? It's just. He has absolutely no right. He comes along in what, season 5, whatever, and then kills a character that's been in it since season 1. It's like,
no, look. It's a good foil for Jon Snow's character, because that young kid, one, killed his only love, and gave him a little nod afterwards. Two. Jon Snow, despite this, takes him under his wing, tries to teach him how to be a future Lord Commander, sort of tries to get him to understand that the Wildlings aren't all that bad, and still gets stabbed because of it. So I feel like, yeah, okay, the kid's really kind of annoying, and obviously you're not supposed to, but you're supposed to feel sympathetic towards him, because he did have his whole family murdered by these guys. It's like, yeah, you're supposed to sort of understand, but I can understand why you're annoyed at the kid, because I think it's just like he's done so many annoying things that's why it's become annoying. But I feel like all those things from his character's perspective are justified.
Yeah, it's like in the last episode when we saw the leaders of the Night's Watch, and you had Alistair Thorne talking to the men. I can't remember the guy's name, but the guy on his left in the scene, he actually seems to regret like their actions. He's like, oh, maybe we've done something wrong here. Whereas this kid, who is a kid, and he should feel bad for what he's done. He's killed a man, but he's actually murdered. It's not out of self-defense or anything.
Mm.
Why haven't we seen? Unless they're just going to get rid of him, they haven't really built him up as a character that we should at least like a little bit, because he's shown no sign of regret, no signs that he even...
Maybe we might see John back alive and he might go, oh, I'm sorry. Or he might just try and stab him again. Little fucking Ollie, he can't stop stabbing people. He's just stabbing left, right, and centre.
Well, I'm hoping. Did you ever watch Stupid? Reminds me of Devil Finger.
Yeah. No, I've never watched that. Is that all you have, like? You just hit Ollie. Is that the only thing you took away from this scene?
Alistair Thorne's an idiot for not planning, like you said. Like, what plan was that? It was over like that. It was just gone.
There wasn't much of a fight when the giant came through the wall, really, was there?
No, it was the scene reminded me of the scene in the Avengers when Loki's fighting the Hulk. Tom.
I don't have that much to say about that scene in general. I agree with you, Glenn, where 1-1 the giant smashes the guy. He kills the guy. I thought it was funny. I don't know if it was meant to be, but.
I think it was supposed to be like that shock factor.
But in terms of the scene itself, Ollie, by the way, I'm going to respectfully disagree with you, Ryan, on this. Everything you said about Ollie, I kind of agree with in terms of if you were to put all that on Alistair Thorne, right? Mm. Alistair Thorne has been at the Watch for a very long time. He should, by his age, he should be a bit more reasonable. He should put his old hatreds aside. But while he's very young, he's not been there a while, he's not part of the Night's Watch. To me, Ollie's actions are justified. And I also agree with what you're saying, Glenn, about John will forgive him as well. John saw his conflicting emotions, and I think Ollie is the only one that is justified in killing Jon Snow.
Yeah, because he's got a pure
hate. I agree with what you're saying. They can argue they're all ridiculous, and the plan was absolutely ridiculous. The wildlings are there, and there's a greater enemy in this. But Ollie is the only one, in my opinion, that is justified, because he's seen. Put yourself in his shoes, right? You're at home. Two people come in. Well, not two people. A gang of people come in, brutally murder and rape your whole village, including your mother, but rape as well, the mother, that was implied. Kill your dad, kill everyone you've ever known. He literally lives in a small village. And that's your first experience as a very young boy. To have them feelings of revenge and pure hatred, and then not even knowing Jon Snow for a long time, he teams up with the very people that are capable of these atrocities. And Ollie is so conflicted on that, because he does like John, but all he thinks what he's been manipulated by the Night's Watch to think what he's doing is right and just. Like, he literally thinks that he's been kind of governed by someone like Ned Stark. He thinks that what he's doing is right. Therefore, I just think to. By the way, Ryan, absolutely everyone apart from me, I think, agrees with what you're saying. I think Ollie's the only one that can justify his actions. I also, yeah, I think that Jon Snow will forgive him completely, and I think that's going to turn around. Everyone that's been slagging off Ollie for two seasons is going to be like, you kind of understand. And I think they will explain it as well. Maybe even in the next episode, I think Ollie's going to, might even join the Night's Watch, be a part of the Night's Watch, and have a complete character shift.
Yeah.
But in terms of that scene, by the way, I just want to back my discussion with you last week, Glenn. I predicted practically word for word Davos and Melisandre.
Yeah.
Exactly how it went down this week. As running was about the Boltons, I said, now he'll say, you've done it before. He'll talk about the shadow demon that killed Renly. He's going to be the one. Davos is going to be the one. I've seen your power. He says them words. So I was while that was all happening, I was going crazy. I love that. But awesome.
Can we talk about that scene then?
You too. Go for it.
Ryan, you had a distinct opinion on this scene.
Did I?
About the length.
No, it's the scene after the whole
like that collectively of like him talking about doing that collectively.
That's literally what took away my 0.5 score. Is for some reason I feel like a lot of things that I've been watching recently, it sticks to me. Whenever these scenes stick around for like uncomfortable amount of times, like they just make it awkward. A scene in Star Wars, like the whole Rey and Kylo Ren thing, it just went on for far too long, and they're doing it in this too. We knew it was going to happen. It was taking forever.
Actually, just to interrupt, sorry. I actually didn't know if they were actually going to do the reveal at the end of this episode. Like, I thought, like, when they were zooming into the body, I thought they might have faked this out. I knew we were going to get it eventually, but I didn't actually know if we were going to get him opening his eyes. And they kept focusing on the wolf as well. I can't remember his name, actually. But, Ghost, sorry. Yeah, they kept focusing on Ghost, and I thought we might get what Tom was talking about. I think it was you, Tom, last week, about him sort of warging into the wolf thing. Yeah, so I thought we might have got that instead of the actual open-eyed reveal. So
I think we did, but I'll wait to my turn.
All right, okay, fair enough.
that would have been nice to have some sort of, like, Jon Snow whilst he was dead. Was in walking into Ghost and doing some sort of Blues Clues sort of thing, like going, who can revive Jon Snow? It's like, and the wolf's like over by Melisandre, just going, behind me, oh,
licking it, come on,
I really like the scene between Davos and Melisandre, like the fact that she is actually doubting her faith, and that was cool to see.
When you compare the acting in that, I thought that scene was one of the best scenes in Game of Thrones in terms of a scene that wasn't an action scene and it was just dialogue. Like both the actor for Davos and Melisandre, because Melisandre, when she was so confident, so headstrong, to see her broken, and then she acted that aspect of Melisandre as well. I thought that both of their acting was absolutely amazing. It was one of my favourite scenes.
Definitely. Yeah. I guess to see her all broken like that, it's almost like seeing Cersei broken, because she comes across so headstrong that now it's kind of nice to see her broken, but now you want her to I don't know. Now I kind of want to see her react to seeing Jon Snow alive. And it'll be nice to actually see her faith revive. No,
do you think? Yeah, do you think she'll immediately go back to being like, oh, this is Azor Ahai, the great leader, blah, 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 or do you think she'll become more humble and actually understand her faith a bit more?
She might. Maybe she'll believe that she's the god herself. Maybe.
She's Ralaw.
No, I don't. I think she'll. She'll be like the other Red Priest that was with the other guy that keeps bringing him up.
Yeah.
She won't be going around praising the gods. She'll just be like, oh, this is my master as such. I'm going to follow him around. I believe that he's going to lead us to good things.
Yeah.
But good scene overall. Just too much awkwardness with that wait.
What do you think, Tom?
I kind of get where you're coming from, Ryan, with the kind of pacing of it. But for me, Jon Snow is the biggest character in Game of Thrones, in my opinion. He's representative of all that's good in the world.
He's the hero, basically.
Honor, duty, etc., etc., etc. And I think the pacing was justified. I think all of the build-up was... I think the writing was absolutely brilliant. I couldn't have done it better myself. This is why I love the episode so much. I'm up there with you with it being a 9, 9.5. The only reason it didn't get a 10 is because action-wise it wasn't. But everything else, in my opinion, was as good as it gets, basically. And I think the biggest character in the whole show getting revived has to have a big moment. And I knew it was going to happen at the end of the episode, and I was sitting there just cheering, like, because I read the books ages before I read the last book before I think the season one started. So I've been wondering about Jon Snow's fate for so long, and to see him be reborn for me was just my favourite moment of the whole series, any season so far. And when he woke up at the end, I've never been more excited about Game of Thrones or an ending. And for me, it was absolutely brilliant. The Davos and the Melisandre was brilliant, and the scene itself was brilliant. I thought there was a lot of subtle things going on. When Ghost just perks up, see Ghost is kind of snoozing, you think, what? Ghost is kind of looking melancholy. And then you just see him, like, ever so gradually sit up, and then you think, this is it. Jon Snow has a big, big connection to his direwolves, as do all of the Starks. Whether it's a Targ, whatever. and he is no exception to that. And I think they've definitely left it open for to reveal that Jon Snow did walk into Ghost the whole time that he was dead.
Mm.
And that he could reference that later as well. He could say to Sam or any of the characters, I was with you the whole time. Not Sam, but you know, anyone else over the wall, I was actually with you the whole time. And I think it'd be really cool because the Worgen aspect, apart from Bran, he was talking about this, Glenn.
Yeah.
Has been quite minimal, which to me is very disappointing because Worgen is one of the most interesting, like, fantasy elements of it.
And I kind of like the fact that the whole Stark family has that ability, sort
of.
Like,
to me, they're descended from the old blood, and to me, that's all. And I think, to see that connection between Ghost and Jon was just brilliant, and, like, I couldn't speak more positively of the scene of the wall. And I'm just really excited to see what... I think Jon Snow's going to start... It's obviously, like, a part of him will be lost. I think that's been, like, metaphorically said several times from several different characters. But I think he will be a strong, fair, just leader like Ned was. But is he better than Ned, actually? Jon is... Ned was a bit too rigid in his system. He is kind of the old world, the old fashioned, about where I think John is kind of, this is all to help him, but he's so aware of the brutality of the Song of Ice and Fire, and all his decisions will be based around that. He's not afraid to do the nitty gritty. And I can't wait to see Jon Snow make some horribly hard decisions, but in the end get it right and be the ruler. And for him to take on authority and crush the fucking Boltons. Anyway, go on, Glenn.
Yeah, no, you've pretty much covered everything I thought about the scene. I agree with you on the fact about him losing a bit of himself, coming back, being that just like Ned-like character, but being even better than Ned, because in all honesty...
You missed an eight, right? Was you not even bothered then when Jon Snow knew it was going to happen? But what? Before the season, we didn't even know it was going to happen. Kit Harrington said, no, I'm dead.
No, I knew he was coming back. I didn't, right, watching the scene as it was happening, I did not know if it was going to be that scene that he comes back. But the way they've built it up, the media attention towards it, is he coming back, the fact that he's been in every single, like, press release, which I think was the wrong thing to do. I think they shouldn't have had him anywhere near Game of Thrones. Like, they should have just...
You had to go on set, though, to film the rest of the scene.
Yeah, no, I mean, like, have him on set, try and keep it a secret, film it inside every single scene. That would be a weird thing to do. It would be a weird thing to do, but it's the best way to keep it quiet.
I just think that's a problem with journalism, the fact that you get the journalists sneaking there going, oh, snaps of Johnson. I don't like that aspect of it.
Even just going back to the books, never mind the media attention, when I read it, I just said, not out of shock, I went, he's not dead. Because George R. R. Martin does this great thing where he, like, when a character dies, they sort of don't know whether they're dead or not. Like, it fades out, sort of thing. And, like, Tyrion, early on in Dance of Dragons, drowns. And you think, I actually thought, oh, this might be the end of Tyrion. And then, obviously, you read on and you find out it's not. But, he ends that book with that Jon Snow slowly dying, and then I think he actually does Warrior and the Wolf, or Wolf, Ghost, he does some sort of thing where he becomes him or something. Yeah, so I was always like, he's not dead. But reading the books, I had no idea how they were going to bring him back or how that was going to play out. But then all the talk of Melisandre, all the talk of resurrection, everyone talking about how that guy, Beric Dondarrion, season 3, came back to life. They planted too many seeds, in my opinion, whereas they should have left it more ambiguous.
Is like, when I first read Jon Snow getting stabbed, right?
Yeah.
All I saw was, like, crackpot theories about him being resurrected online. But now, like, obviously recently, it's been really brought to attention, but when I first read it, I'm saying, like, and like you say, like, to when this season started, everything they've done this season, I knew he was coming back. But before that, there was a bit of doubt in my mind. I thought he definitely should come back, but like
my only thing about me being so certain on it was the fact that there's differences in killing characters for shock value and killing characters for a purpose. And there was no purpose to killing Jon Snow. Like, that character's been built up so much that if you kept him dead, what was the point?
Nobody's safe.
I don't agree with that, though.
Like, major characters are going to die before
There's three, maybe four untouchables. There's Daenerys.
No, one untouchable. There's one.
No, there's not. There's three.
There is one untouchable.
Well, watch what George R. R. Martin says. He's thrown a curveball, right? There's four. Maybe three. Is it Jon Snow?
No, it's Arya.
Okay.
The only person that's safe is Arya because his wife. It's his wife's favourite character, and she says she won't speak to him if he kills her off. Arya's a favourite character. Nobody's said it in millions of interviews.
She was my fourth, right? She was my fourth. But the other three, everyone knows, is the three heads of the dragon. Tyrion, Daenerys, Jon, right?
Bran's one of them anyway, so you're wrong there.
Shut up. Right, anyway. they're the ones that, in my eyes, are untouchable. Yes, they could kill one of them, at least, at the end. But I think we're going to get, like, a Star Wars moment where Daenerys is standing at the top and she's handing out medals and everyone's smiling and Ghost stands up and growls. You know, that sort of... we're going to get a feel-good moment at the end, but...
Bittersweet.
Bittersweet, yeah. Yeah, okay, one of them could die. Tyrion's actually probably quite likely to die somehow, like, maybe in battle or something, which would be quite interesting. But, yeah, to me, okay, Jon's not untouchable in maybe the last book, but to kill him off midway through, which I feel is midway through the story.
He's kind of Dancing Dragon 2, though.
Yeah, I know, but there's still a lot to happen. There's still the battle between the others, and you've built that up so much with Jon Snow's character. Like, Jon's at the forefront of that battle, so to kill him off and not have him play out the battle at all would confuse, like, it doesn't make any narrative sense, I don't think.
I think to, like, talk in any kind of certainty is folly, like...
But I was so certain about Jon Snow.
You would med, Rob. You're right, and you will be right, and I don't think you will kill off Jon, but it's not... Nothing certain, like...
He could kill Jon. Right.
He's a dictator, he can do what he wants.
Yeah, of course.
What you're saying is right, but to say it in terms of, like... But you... Danny can't die, Jon can't die.
No, but every author is still... No matter how flexible you are with the narrative, you're still bound by the rules of a narrative, where you...
No,
you're not. Yeah, you are. Right, Rob had no real role in the overall story. Yeah, he was part of the Battle of the Five Kings, but we all know the Battle of the Five Kings is inconsequential anyway, because it doesn't matter. No one cares about the throne. It's actually about the battle with the White Walkers. So that battle was just...
I'm sure all the people that died care about it.
What?
No one cares about it.
No, I mean, everyone, the whole world cared about it, but it's inconsequential to what's actually happening in the plot. If you know what I mean, like, the overall narrative is this seemingly undefeatable army, and how are they going to beat it? That to me is the overall narrative of A Song of Ice and Fire.
That's
like,
the end game, yeah, but...
Yeah, but that's what I mean. You have to build towards that end goal no matter where you start from. So to have that, like, the Battle of the Five Kings was just a side quest, basically, along the road to that.
That line of thinking is... All of Varys' plot is consequential because what makes us human is the most interesting part. To me, the Lord of the Rings, their evil, we're good aspect is the least important.
Yeah, no, I know, I understand that. But you still couldn't have Frodo in the Two Towers, Gollum bashes him over the head and knocks him off the rock. You couldn't have that. Because we know what's going to happen. Frodo's going to get to the end. He's going to throw the ring in the thing.
Yeah, so, but he doesn't have to the rules.
We know Daenerys, Jon, and Tyrion.
Everyone thinks Daenerys is going to die on the internet.
Yeah, but again, what would be the point? Let's say Daenerys died this season.
Could take over.
No, but what's the point in the last? What's the point in her story then? What is the point in that character? Other than sitting around, twiddling her thumbs, right, thinking of a red door.
Look at it this way, right? Imagine, like, War of the Roses or Imperial Rome. Imagine anything like that. There's no... What was the point of Caesar?
That's different. That's a bit.
Right, no, it's a plot, but his whole thing is like the good guys don't necessarily win.
I know. Yeah,
it's
okay.
It's based on what could realistically happen with such sadistic game-playing characters. That's why horrible characters like Ramsay's still around. That's why Littlefinger.
Yeah, but right. Okay.
There was.
Let's use Ramsay.
There was a purpose.
Sorry, Ryan. I'll let you speak in a minute. Let's use Ramsay as an example.
Fucking hell.
Ramsay isn't gonna be sitting on the Iron Throne at the end of the story.
I fucking love it if he was.
Yeah, but we know he's eventually gonna fall.
Yeah,
that's the point of his character, is to be so despicable that we root for his demise, and that demise eventually comes at one from one of our favorite characters. yes, he played with that a bit with Rob, because originally, if you're not in the know, that Rob's that character. You're rooting for him. You want him to take the throne. You want him to do all this, and then they kill him off as a shock factor. But at the end of the day, Rob was never going to be there at the end. You know, okay, it might be easy to say that now, but Rob was never going to be there at the end fighting whites and, you know, all that shit. So, he could have been, but I don't feel like killing him off wasn't he killed him off early enough that it was inconsequential to the rest of the story. That's what I think. Anyway, Ryan, go ahead before I rant forever.
I feel like characters like Daenerys, they kind of are expendable now because she's kind of done all of the heavy work for Tyrion. So, like, she's basically...
No, that can't be her character. That can't be her character.
That's the thing. Like, that's the good thing about... That's the good thing about Game of Thrones is that a character can just die. Like, yeah. if they decide in the show not to do that, I'm going to be angry. I'm going to be upset with it because that's the whole point of Game of Thrones. That's what makes it interesting, is that you're reading and then a character that you've invested so much into is just gone. The Hound. The Hound had so many good chapters. There was so much. He pretty much had all of these. If you was to show on a tree how many people he'd interacted with and affected in some way, there's loads of characters that he has had some effect on, and then he's just gone. Like, okay,
for me, his purpose is simply to teach us, the reader, about the world, like how brutal it is, the knights. But he has no bearing. He has no bearing to the end plot, in my opinion.
You're saying it in terms of like, every character has their use, and then once they've run out of it, they're expendable. But you're not kind of factoring into account the idea that everybody's will is working against one another, and it's not necessarily going to be what's right for the plot is what's going to happen, right? So it's like, that's why Ramsay's carried on as long as it has. Like, if he could have easily killed him off way before this, but he has stuck around because he's got a large army and whatnot. These factors, it's like, we're originally supposed to be supporting the Starks. All the main characters in Game of Thrones are Starks originally. Yeah. Not all of them, most of them, sorry.
No, I feel like it is Stark story.
The Starks, all their men are dead. All of them. There's no, but for the fate of the story, like, it's brutal, medieval, gritty realism in them terms. But what you're saying about, like, Jon Snow's got to survive to the end because he serves a purpose in terms of the plot, is what drives him. But, I don't know, at the same time, countering that, you can't go as far as, well, he's got his purposes to do this and to do this and to do this. I thought that the Hound and Sansa had to, I thought that thematically, as a plot, they should be getting together. They didn't. There's so many plots that you look at that and you say, oh, that's leading to that, and he just cuts it off.
Yeah.
Like Rob Stark, you talk about, the only justification I would give for it being fine that Rob dies because he doesn't get a POV. If he got a POV, I think it would be even worse. And like
that was what the big thing with Ned was, that we were like, Ned seems like the main character in the first book.
Yeah.
And then they kill him. Yeah. But
that's a warning for the rest of it.
Nobody, no, I know it's a warning. Nobody. But if Ned hasn't had 5 books, right? Okay, it was shocking, but they didn't build him up to the point where he's now. We're getting near the end game for this series, really. It's kind of halfway through. It's kind of halfway to the end. So it's hard to explain. Like, there's a lot still to happen, but it's drawn towards more of the battle up north rather than the mini battle that was happening with the five kings. So,
but you know, like, let's disagree. Say, right, Boromir, Lord of the Rings, classic fantasy character, redeems himself before he dies. Justice, fairness. Robert dies in a horrific way. Something completely unjust. Wallafrey breaks guest right. Something that culturally in their world is like the worst thing that you can possibly do. He's a dire sawn into his head. He's only 15 years old. Like, a lot of people had a big affiliation with his character. What Ryan earlier on was saying is right. Like, this is Game of Thrones, and anyone can die. Anyone. It's not like other, it's not like anything else in that way.
But the thing I've had with characters beforehand. All right, yeah, the shock factor is in it, but I never felt like, okay, if I look back on that character, what was the point in them?
Ned had a point.
What?
Doran Martell got
no, that's the show in the book that I'm not even going with Dorn. That defeats my point, Dorn. Dorn goes the opposite of what I think. Let's use Dorn as an example. What was the point in that character? What was the point? I don't understand the point in that character. Why introduce him? Why use him at all? What was the point? If they're just going to kill him off. And that's the same thing with Jon Snow. If they eventually kill Jon Snow, which isn't the case now, but you never know, he might die again. But if they eventually kill... Well, it doesn't matter, because he can just be resurrected again. But if they eventually kill Jon Snow, I just look back on his character and go, so everything we've been leaning towards, and I know this is the point of Game of Thrones, is that no one's safe, but everything we've been leaning towards... is pointless. It just, like, with Rob, that was the point of his character, was that everything he did was pointless. That was he's just going to be in human history.
That's not what he did.
Yeah, it is.
Pointless. He had a just cause. He's fighting.
I'm not saying his motive was pointless. I'm saying he'll just be a blot in the history books as one of the five kings that died. But we are in a more personal level with him. But in terms of the overall narrative, he's just going to be a blot on the rest of the tale, if you know what I mean. So
it's the difference between fate and consequence, what we're arguing at the moment.
Yeah, yeah.
Consequence, fate and coincidence, I mean.
Yeah.
And I think specifically Martin's writing deeply plays upon coincidence in terms of minds clashing with each other, and it's not what the victors aren't who you expect, and people don't die, and it's like Rob Boromir redeems himself. Oh no, you know, Aragorn tells him he's a good man before he dies, and he's got his sword in his chest and he dies as an honourable warrior.
Yeah,
Rob gets he's already dead, but Rob dies in this humiliating way, which is completely contrary to fantasy. It's like it's a blending of them genres. And what I like, mostly agree with what you're saying, but I think you can't kind of underestimate the fact that a lot of it, like, it's not just all fate. This character's leading towards this point, and they're going to smoothly just flow there.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
No, I don't doubt the fact that it's not going to play out how everyone, like, it's not going to be conventional the way it plays out. I understand that fact, because that's why I love Game of Thrones, because you never know what's going to happen. You can talk about predictions forever, and they can just turn it on its head. So that is the best thing about it. But I just feel like these characters, like. Other characters that have died in the past, I haven't been pissed off about their death. I've been shocked. And I'm not like pissed off in a sense. I've been annoyed, like, in terms of, oh, I really love that character. Like, Oberyn especially, like, they introduced him so well, and when they kill him off, you're like, oh, no. Like, I thought he was going to be the guy that helped Tyrion out and all this. And that was good. But I just feel like if they were to kill off Jon or Tyrion, maybe especially Tyrion or Daenerys, I wouldn't to have that, oh no, I'd be like, why? It just wouldn't make sense to me. But anyway. I'll be talking about this all night if I keep going, so.
When Rob died, though, when I read it, I felt so sick and I couldn't read it for days.
Well, I had that ruined for me, so that's another story. Yeah. Anyway.
Anyway, I think we should wrap this up. Yeah, let's just
final thoughts. Go ahead.
Like one big prediction and then sign off.
For the next episode.
Just a general prediction for next episode.
Next episode, right? I can't think of anything actually. Ryan, you start and I'll come back to me.
John is going to kill someone. Be it Brat Child or Fawn.
He's not going to kill all.
This one behead all at a time. He lines them up in a row. Gets
his Valyrian sword.
Segway. Just slide.
They have segways on the watch.
Yeah.
Okay, is that your big prediction? Then John's gonna exact his what he feels is justice.
It will be on at least one person before like Davos stops him and is like, no, like you've got to rest. You've just come back from the dead. Stop what you're doing. I think he will want to take revenge, even though it's not his character. I think he's going to lose that part of him at first.
Yeah.
If it comes back to him, I don't know, but I'd be disappointed if he just comes back and he's cool with it. I know I wouldn't be.
Oh, you Thorn, you're up to no good all the time. Ah, yeah. Oh, shucks.
It's like the Fawn, and then running away like in a convertible, like that's
right. Okay, your big predictions, Jon Snow's wrath. Okay,
yeah.
Tom, go ahead.
I'm just gonna go for something. I think that it might not even be the worst thing to happen. Euron Greyjoy assassinates Theon Greyjoy. No, not himself. Not necessarily himself.
Yeah, he's going to have someone do it for him.
Theon goes back to the Iron Islands, and then that means, and then the implication is that Theon would rule because he's his last son, and then Euron has him killed.
Just basically getting rid of loose ends. That's what you're...
Because for Euron to rule, obviously, Theon, yeah.
Yeah.
That's my big prediction.
What's his sister's name again?
Yara.
Do you think that she will see Fionn come back and feel threatened that he's going to basically claim the right to the throne? And she might even... Because earlier on I said it might be like a brother or sister.
She has sort of turned her back on him because she saw how weak he was. So that's not bad. Yeah, she might just see him as a threat now and just get rid of him. That'd be an interesting... No?
I love that.
All right. I'd love it if I was right.
Don't worry. This is the great thing about recording this. We've got all these predictions on video.
I think you're this...
Right, okay.
Probably more likely.
I've got two. So I think we're definitely going to see the King's Moot. Because it'd be a bit weird.
That's not a fucking prediction.
No. Okay, I've got one then.
You might see Jamie the Fifth.
This is the prediction based on fact. Well, based on what I know is going to happen in the next episode. So we're getting the Tower of Joy scene. I think we're going to be introduced to Howland Reed in depth.
Oh, that's big. Because I
think they're going to introduce him through Sansa or some way, like. You know,
that's a great show. I love it.
That's where her best way to find refuge, I think, would be is through the Reeds. And then we're also going to get to see the Ned's secret. Lyanna dying on a bed. And the reveal. That's what
John
I think.
Targaryen.
We're gonna see the reveal of John Targaryen next episode.
How many predictions are you allowed anyway?
Well, that's kind of collectively one, because that's the Tower of Joy scene. And I think it's going to play out how we all suspect. So we're going to see Howland Reed save Ned's life, and then we're going to see Ned.
We still have the resurrection. Everyone expected that. We're just going to see another thing, another like reveal that we already knew.
No, but show people don't know this. Like, some might know the theory, but it's really a book thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
By the way, D&D were asked by George R. Martin, he asked them who was Jon Snow's mother, and if they got it right, they were allowed to film Game of Thrones.
Right, okay. Yeah, so... So it was that tavern wench that Ned shagged in. It's gonna be really disappointing.
I feel like for him to ask that, it must be a really big deal, and for that big theory to be true.
Yeah. Ryan, you gonna say something?
I was, but it's gone. Sorry.
It's getting to that time of night, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right, just to recap our predictions. Tom, you think... what was it again? The
Euron's going to have Theon.
Oh, that's it, yeah.
Theon comes back, maybe meets with Yara. Euron assassinates him, or gets him.
So we're going to get the third big death in a row, because we've kind of got a death every episode so far of, like, major characters. So, yeah. Ryan, what was yours again, sorry?
John killing someone.
Oh, yeah.
That's what I was gonna say. Or we're not gonna see John at all, and they're gonna like tease us with flashbacks and that. But
please.
It's just gonna tease us and be like, "Oh, you want to see Jon Snow, do you? Well, here's some more of Dawn."
They're trying to lose Yeah, and mine's just the introduction of Halla Reed. And R plus L equals J.
Yes!
And on that,
I love yours more than my own, Glenn, to be honest.
On that, it's not gonna happen like that. On that, we'll call it a day, I think.
Night, guys.
See you later. Bye.
All right, bye.